Here we go.
Good evening and welcome to Full On Football, the show that promotes all branches of the round ball game played in South Australia. My name is Nat Adamopoulos, and along with my co-host, whom I'll introduce shortly, we'll be bringing you all the news and results of the games being played in all the South Australian local leagues. Now, speaking of my co-host, he's a man who doesn't really need an introduction. He's well known and has played in all levels of South Australian football, and is, I think, currently in his 20th year of senior football, correct me if I'm wrong. Good evening, Nat. And a warm welcome to Micheal Brooks.
Thanks, Nat. Good evening. Yeah, you didn't have to mention the 20 years, Nat.
Is it 20 years?
Yes, started off at Salisbury back in the young days.
20 years, so. Fantastic. Listen, before you tell everyone who's on the show tonight, I just wanted to give the viewers a bit of an idea of what Full On Football is all about. Full On Football is a show that's trying to get information from all the local leagues that are played in South Australia. So each week we will be focusing on the Super League, Premier League, State League, Women's, Juniors and Amateurs. But we'll also be bringing you information about under-19s and under-23s, SASSI programs, futsal when that season starts, the school competitions, which is SAPSASA and SASA, regional soccer, which is played, and basically all areas of football that are played in South Australia. So we're trying to become like a central place for all your information. And we would like everyone to send in their information to us so we can give it out to all the viewers. Now that you know a little bit more about us, Brooksy, would like to introduce our guest panellists, actually.
We certainly would, but before I do introduce our guest panellist, Nat, I'd like to say, coming up on tonight's show, we've got Alison Miller, the CEO of the FFSA, Micheal Petrillo, the CEO of Adelaide United, and also the head coach of the Adelaide Galaxy Football Club, Bill Bailey, the president of the Amateurs, Jim Savalas, the president of Adelaide Comets, and Wendy Carter, the CEO of Saucer. But now to introduce our guest panellists. This person has represented Australia and SA as a player. He's won 3 NSL Championship medals with Adelaide City, 2 Cup winners medals. He was the Adelaide City Player of the Year on 3 consecutive years, 86, 87 and 88. Played 361 NSL games for his beloved black and whites. He was last year inducted into the Football Hall of Fame. It's no one other than Jumping Joe Mullen. Joe, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, Joe.
Brooksy and Nat, thank you.
Joe, how's now the coach of the Croydon Kings? How's things going down there at Kingland?
Kingland. It's been a very long pre-season, I've got to say. We started at the back end of November last year, as probably most clubs did. And the players have been in preparation for probably now about 19, 20 weeks. So this first game proper for 3 points was very welcome. And the players, it's good to have that under our belts. And now we can get on the season proper. We're looking forward to it.
Great stuff, Joe. We'll talk a little bit more about Croydon and the Premier League a little bit later on in the show. But we'll take a short break. Coming up after the break, we'll have Alison Miller, the CEO of the FFSA.
Bianco Building Supplies have been providing quality goods and specialised services to the building industry since 1977. Their staff pride themselves in providing total quality customer service. Whether you require machinery, building supplies, drainage, structural reinforcing steel, or hiring of portable on-site buildings, Bianco's friendly and dedicated staff are only too happy to meet your requirements. And if it's safety products you're after, Bianco Safety have an extensive range to choose from. Their safety van can come direct to you, fit out and supply all your safety needs for your worksite. Visit www.bianco.com.au to have a look at their fantastic range of products. Bianco, number one for all your building and safety supplies. Welcome back to the show. Full On Football is very proud to welcome our next guest, this very special guest. It's someone that we all need to get to know and actually finally put a face to a name. It's the CEO of the Football Federation of South Australia, Alison Miller. Welcome to the show, Alison.
Thank you very much for inviting me on, Natalie.
Thank you. Now, look, we all know that the FFSA is now responsible for the administration and promotion and delivery of the of football in South Australia. I've had a lot of people ask me, why the restructure? Why was the competition not left the way it was, but why has it been restructured?
Mm-hmm. It's kind of a bit of a long story, but I'll try and make it fairly short. The new Football Federation Board came in and was given the mandate to run the senior men's competition in this state. To do that, we had to get all the clubs to sign up with us, and I think any kind of change is very hard to get across, and I think there was a bit of miscommunication there. But at the deadline that we'd set for everyone to come on board, we only had four clubs. So the board then made a decision that they would open tender for anybody to put their name forward to come in, and we would run with a league or leagues based on the number of clubs that we got. After that enrolment date, if you like, passed, we had 28 clubs, which we couldn't conceivably put into two divisions. Mm-hmm. So that's how the three divisions were born.
And now that the three divisions are born, Alison, how have the clubs accepted the final decision and now finally the league's kicked off? What's the feedback and the feeling from the clubs? Is everyone happy and hunky-dory?
I'd have to say, on the balance, that we're getting pretty positive feedback. I think once, obviously, the games start, that all people want to do is go out and play football. But I think the way the leagues have actually, the best Super League, the Premier League and the State League, the way the clubs have been aggregated in those leagues, there's going to be some very strong competition. And I think people are seeing this as a real breath of fresh air. Yeah. And I hope now that more of them have got to know us and got to know that we're actually about trying to improve things, trying to improve the promotion of the game. And I think creating a Super League is probably going to do a lot more for the promotion of the game. I'm hoping that people will actually understand the rationale behind it and go out there and have some very enjoyable sport.
And hopefully with forums like this, you're able to put that message across and just re-enhance what it is that you've been trying to do all along.
Absolutely.
Have you found, Alison, coming into what's really a male-dominated sport as a female coming into the top job in South Australia, have you found the digression into administration into our football game from your perspective?
How have I found it? I've spent a number of years working in male-dominated areas, both in sports and some time ago in the criminal justice system. So working in male-dominated areas isn't new to me. But I have to say that I've found that the administrators in this sport are very welcoming. Mm. And I certainly frequently turn up and I'm the only female or one of two or three females out of 100. And I don't seem to notice that until it's pointed out. So I think maybe that's indicative of the way that the community has been fairly welcoming.
But would it be true to say that the passion of these administrators that you've been dealing with at the club level in particular has been really strong? That is something that I've certainly noticed coming back into South Australia. The passion of all the different clubs and the people representing those clubs have been very, very strong. Have you found that?
Yeah, look, absolutely. And I think one of the things that needs to be recognised is a lot of these passionate people, well, most of them, are volunteers in what they're doing and that they're putting their life into the sport, and that needs to be recognised.
Alison, of course, you had your season launch on Wednesday, the 5th of April, and it seemed to go very well. Everyone enjoyed themselves. Have you got anything that you'd like to say about that morning, the breakfast launch?
I thought it went really well as well. I was very, very pleased with it, and more particularly, I was pleased at the turnout from the clubs. Almost all of the clubs were represented by at least the captain of their senior team and the coach, and in most cases by the president or chairperson of the club as well. Mm. And it was also good to see that the clubs were actually all talking to each other in a setting that was outside the football setting. Mm. So, you know, quite a few of the State League clubs were sitting at the same table together. And I think that was a good thing, is to get people in a social setting and talking about the game outside of the competitive setting.
Yeah, most definitely.
Now, Alison, something that's been publicised recently is prize money for the Area Cup and the Llanelligich Cup, the Super League, Premier League, State League champions and runners-up all the way through. Has it been easier, do you think, with the restructure to be able to gain sponsors on board in terms of trying to sell it to potential sponsors?
Yes, definitely. I think as much as anything, it's the perception that things are changing and that we're putting a lot of effort into promoting it and into strengthening it by reducing the number of clubs in each league and calling one of them a Super League. I think some of that is getting out there, and certainly when we first went approaching sponsors, we found a very favourable response and people saying things like, you know, the change is really good. It just shows... It would have been easy to just go with the existing structure, but I think even though we didn't originally intend the change as it's happened, it's probably been a good
thing.
Worked out
for the best. Yeah.
Has the success of our National League club, our A-League club, Adelaide United, has the success of that club been helped in gaining those sponsors and getting some of these people come on board as well? Because they have been tremendous for our community. Adelaide United, how has that club helped?
Oh look, I think the Football Federation SA and Adelaide United will have a very close and strong relationship, and of course we do have some of their sponsors that have come on board. In fact, last week we announced Club Finance and Scalzi Produce, as well as them advertising as new sponsors, and they've already obviously been key sponsors of Adelaide United.
So we appreciate giving up your time to be with us on TV and let everyone else, as I said, put a face to a name. They've heard all about you. They've heard the fantastic hard work that you've been doing within the FFSA. And now they can put a face to your name. Wish you all the best for the rest of the season and hope you don't have too many problems. And as I said, thanks again for coming in today.
And thank you very much, all of you, for inviting me on. And you're too kind, Nat.
No.
Thanks for
give credit where credit's due.
Congratulations, Alison. We really mean that. It's no doubt been a tough and difficult job to start with, but hopefully there's smooth sailing on the waters ahead.
Thanks.
Okay. Alison Miller, the CEO of the FFSA. When we come back from a break, we'll have the Premier League wrap. Port Road Sports Store. If it's football gear you want, come into Port Road Sports Store, your football specialist store. Official outlet for all Adelaide United merchandise. Stocking football brands like Umbro, Mitre, Lotto, Kelme and Roosh. Come in and see their extensive range of sporting goods and equipment. Port Road Sports Store, 142 Port Road, Hindmarsh, proudly supporting football since 1982. Welcome back to Full On Football. We'll now start with our Super League wrap, and I'd like to introduce to you our very special guest, the Adelaide Galaxy coach and CEO of Adelaide United, Michael Pacciullo. Michael, welcome to Full On Football.
Thanks, Michael. Thank you.
Good win on Friday night, first up.
Yeah, it was an excellent win. It's good to start off with a win, especially down at Modbury. I've gone there quite a few times with some good sides and always had a hard time, so it was good to win.
And especially after losing the Lanelagich Cup the week before to the same opponents.
Yeah, big turnaround, Mike, you know, from the week before, although we had a different team on the park and shuffled things around a little bit. So it was, the boys played very well. I was very happy with the effort, you know, all around. It was a good, really good team effort.
And now we'll just have a look at the actual teams which are in the Super League for 2006. We have Adelaide Blue Eagles, Adelaide City, Adelaide Olympic, Campbelltown City, Cumberland United, Modbury Soccer Club, North East Metro Stars, Raiders, White City Woodville and Adelaide Galaxy. And Michael, the victory was a good victory, but a bit of a bittersweet victory with Andy Lean breaking his leg right towards the end of the game.
Yeah, unfortunately, you know, a couple of minutes ago, Nat, he copped a bad one in the shins and broke both the tibia and the fibula and had a steel rod put in the leg Friday night with 8 screws and... he's on the way back home, I think, today or tomorrow. So, yeah, unfortunate incident and took, as you say, a lot of the gloss off the win. But a great win nevertheless.
Mm. Michael, how were the boys after, obviously, Andy breaking his leg? By all reports, he's a popular lad around the club. How was the mood in the change rooms after the game?
Yeah, pretty subdued, Mike. You know, you think you go down to Modbury and they've got a really, very good team and, you know, we've got fairly young side coming up from the state league, you'd think there'd be a fair bit of singing and carrying on, but the club song wasn't sung, and the boys were pretty subdued, to be honest. Yeah, just felt for Andy's very popular guy.
Michael, the whole round, the first round of the Super League looked very promising before the games kicked off, but there was not very many goals scored, which suggests to me that it's going to be a very tight league and one that's going to be very keenly contested. With the teams that you've already seen in the pre-season Araya Cup, what's your view of the season? Who are the standout teams?
I think it's going to be a lot more even than what it has in the past. I still think probably Metro's got the best list. I think Adelaide City are going to be very, very tough to beat. They've strengthened their side from last year. Modbury, you know, 10 new players that we counted the other day. But I think those teams will be the front runners. But on any given day, I think Friday and Saturday prove that if you're not on your guard, yeah, anybody can beat anybody on any given day. And I think it's going to be a lot more even. I certainly wouldn't expect Metro to be running away with it, but I think they'll be the front runners.
Yes, just talking of the results, let's go through them. We had Adelaide City and White City play on Friday night with a nil-all draw there. And also Modbury and yourselves Galaxy on Friday night with a 1-0 win to Galaxy. Campbelltown and Olympic, a 1-all draw. Cumberland and Blue Eagles, a win to Cumberland there was actually surprising because I thought that Blue Eagles would possibly get up on the top of Cumberland, but Cumberland, to their credit, played excellent, all thanks to their dynamic goalkeeper, Mike Harkness, who pulled off some absolutely fantastic saves, really won the game from there. And who else do we have? Raiders and Metro Stars drew nil-all. How was that game,
It was Michael? A pretty fiery contest, Nat. There's a bit of history and tension there amongst probably both clubs from the past. And look, there was no quarter asked and no quarter given. It was very evenly contested. Raiders had a player sent off with perhaps 20 minutes to go, but stood firm. I thought overall Metro probably had the more dominant of the play, but unfortunately they were just unable to break the Raiders' defence down and get that elusive goal. But it was a good match, and I definitely think those two teams are going to be around the mark, as Michael alluded to earlier.
Well, actually, this round we have had quite a number of injuries at the Cumberland game. Our cameras were actually there on Saturday, and it was a very hard contested game for the first 10 minutes, very physical. But then after that, Cumberland really got on top of Eagles and it took the game right away from them. Basically, I haven't seen Eagles play like that. They looked lost for a while. Their top players weren't performing very well. Second half was a totally different matter. Blue Eagles came out, all guns are blazing, and they were there to try and get the equaliser, if not win. Ange Giannito is absolutely wonderful to watch as a coach, because if you're not really interested in the game, he is so animated, he is so loud on that sideline. Unbelievable person to watch. And as I said, Harkness, some brilliant saves, absolutely brilliant saves. He really did win that game for them. Also another terrible injury coming there to Adelaide Blue Eagles, Mauro Baron, doing a knee. Could be out for most of the season.
It'll be a blow to the Blue Eagles lineup, because I rate him as probably their chief playmaker, and I will know from playing against them everything that goes forward through him, Michael. And if he's out for the season, that's a massive blow for the Blue Eagles, along with Donato Duazo, who's retired this year. So that's would have left a bit of a hole in the Blue Eagles' defence also.
Yeah, he's a great player, and we certainly miss him if he's out for the season.
Yes.
Yeah.
And Harkness had his best game of the for quite a while, I'm led to believe in that.
Fantastic, absolutely fantastic. Half a dozen times Blue Eagles came down and with some cracker shots, and you know, to his credit, he stopped every one of them. He was determined that they were not going to give up that one goal buffer. So.
Michael, first past the post this year to determine the champion side. As a coach, how are you approaching that? Are you approaching it in any different way? Because, of course, we get to the normal time of August and September where you've got a second chance, so to speak, if you haven't made it, if you haven't traditionally finished first. Are you taking it any particular way this year in relation to that?
I think from a coaching point of view, Joe, you can't take any chances at all. I mean, in the past, you probably could rest, say, Brooksy or someone like that if he wasn't quite right. Mm. But now, if you've got a Brooksy in your team and he's not quite right, you're probably going to play because you just can't afford to lose any points. You know, you lose a point here, a point there, and it could cost you the championship. Whereas, you know, you could finish second or third, sometimes fourth, and still win a championship in the past. You just can't do that anymore. And I certainly won't be taking games as lightly as I have taken some other games in the past. For example, you know, playing players that maybe 99% I'll play them this time instead of resting.
Yeah, you certainly want to be in the competition for as long as possible. Yeah. And I think looking at the at the maths, probably three games, possibly maximum four, depending on how tight the competition is going to be.
Yeah.
If you drop any more than three or definitely four, then the championship's virtually gone.
I think you're right, Joe. That's what we've sort of banked on, you know, three to four losses at the most if you want to win the championship. Mm. If you lose any more than that, I think you're out of the ballpark.
Mm. But it is going to be interesting, Michael, because you look at the fixtures on a weekly scale, and you can just see upsets coming where perhaps unjustly they are going to be upsets. Anyone can beat anyone on any given day.
Yeah, as I said, Friday and Saturday showed it. I think Cumberland and Blue Eagles and ourselves and Modbury and White City and Adelaide City and Metro and Raiders.
That was surprising.
Very tight games. And I mean, we played Cumberland a couple of weeks ago and had an easy win, and they come out and beat Blue Eagles. So, no, you can't even afford a mistake, probably. Mm. And similar to the A-League, you know. Mm. The less teams there are, the less margin there is for error.
Now, just on Galaxy, Michael, you've got a rather large squad. Mm-hmm. Can you give us some names who perhaps people can watch out for on a Saturday afternoon?
Players that are new to the club, Mike, there's Vince Camizzi, who made his debut off the bench on Friday night. Unfortunately, Andy Lean, who's gone. Robbie Bache and Aaron Golding, who've come in from Adelaide United. A couple of young players, Matthew Muscroft, who's come over from South Adelaide. Sam Gounder from the AIS. Angelo Ambratsis, a young lad from Adelaide City, who started on Friday night and has played really well.
Had a good game, didn't he?
Looked lively.
Yeah, he is lively, and he's basically scored in every single game that we've played this year, and unfortunately missed an easy chance in the first half, but did his job. He did exactly what I asked him to do in the first half. Yeah, so we've got some fairly young boys. Paul Karatavlis has joined us, and just recently Costas Salapasidis as well, and Toby Nelson.
I'm just looking here at your ins. There's 13 signings you've got. 13.
Yeah,
that's
a lot.
Quite a lot.
Yeah, we've lost a lot. I'm not sure how many have gone out, but Barbiero and Ferranti and Gurgis.
Yeah, probably the same, probably a dozen or so that have gone.
And recently just Carlo Costello and Daniel Mignoni have gone, so,
Michael, one player that's impressed me in a couple of games that I've seen Galaxy play is he looks a young player, I'm not sure how old he is, Steve Grelly.
Yes.
Give us a bit of an insight as to what makes him tick?
Yeah, Steven's a very similar player to Fabian Barbiero. Had him last year. Fabian missed the first half of the season, then came into the side and played really well for us. We were really upset to see him go to Metros, but we wish him all the best. Stephen's very similar, very skillful on the ball, well balanced, very strong, really strong player, super fit, great engine, and has got some good vision. He's only just turned 20 years of age, so expecting big things from Stephen.
Michael, the Adelaide United players, of course, the goalkeeper and Aaron Golding, will of course enhance any side.
Yep.
How do you balance the selection of an Adelaide United player coming into the season for probably only, nine games or half of the year, and how will that impact on the rest of the squad?
Joe, our senior players have taken a long time to get into the side. Vince Camizzi, for instance, has missed most of the pre-season. Sam Barbro, who will start training this week. Costas Salapasidis, who just signed. So we had a very, very young list, and I thought Aaron would add a bit of experience to that side, even if it was for the first few weeks, and that would balance out not having the other players available early on. But so I think that'll be a natural sort of transition, with Aaron will hop out and the other boys will come in over a period of time.
Just one player that I did notice was sort of cumbersome in his walk across the field was obviously Anthony Tassie-Breeden, bringing Robbie Bache in. How have you consoled him, if you like, to let him know that he has still got a future with the club and that he is still very much part of your plans?
Yeah, it's a difficult one, Mike. You know, Tassie a couple of weeks ago looked like he might miss 4 or 5 weeks with a shoulder injury, and he's got a bit of a knee problem. So with at that stage there, we didn't have another keeper to back him up. So Robbie was available. In fact, we thought Robbie was going to Croydon, and Joe sort of changed his mind at the last minute, and Robbie was sort of sitting there. We thought, well, let's use Robbie for the first few weeks if Tassie's going to be out. But Tassie's recovered fairly quickly. We're hoping he sticks around and hangs in there for the next few weeks.
Now, you were saying how every week's going to be fairly close. Let's have a look at the fixtures for round two. We have Adelaide Galaxy yourselves taking on Campbelltown City at home. That should be an interesting match there. Adelaide Olympic taking on Cumberland. Now, I think that'll be a very good game to watch.
We might just get Michael's opinion on that as we run through these, just maybe picking a winner for us, Michael, if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
The Adelaide Olympic and
Galaxy Cumberland. Galaxy for Michael off, well, off we know the that top one there. Off we the don't top. Have to ask him. How about Olympic and Cumberland? What do you think?
Yeah, look, I've seen both those teams over the last 3 weeks. I mean, we played Cumberland a few weeks ago. They had a couple of players out. And I saw Olympic on Saturday, and they were very good in the second half. A little bit average in the first half. It was a game of conflicting halves.
Yes. You know.
But look, I think probably a draw there. It'll be a tough one.
And that's at Hanson Reserve, where Olympic is going to be playing all their games at Hanson Reserve this year. We've got Blue Eagles up against Adelaide City at Marden. Now, last time I saw them in the Area Cup, that was a really great game. That was a fantastic matchups. Considering that Baron is out now, it might be interesting. And I think Sergi's got a hamstring and Peroni's got a groin injury.
Right, Sergi would have two hamstrings now.
Well, injury-wise, so that'll be... I would say possibly Adelaide City will get up on top of Blue Eagles there. And what do you think, Michael?
Yeah, you think Adelaide City would be favourites with Blue Eagles losing Baron. I agree with Mike. I think he's their key player and most things go through Mara and I think they'll miss him badly.
Definitely.
And Freddie Agis going back to play against the club he represented last year, Blue Eagles. So that'll be an interesting battle there.
It will be interesting. Well, then we have White City Woodville v Raiders at Frank Mitchell Park, and they're always very volatile games. Well,
I've played in a couple, and Michael's coached them in a few. So they are very... There's a lot of tension
highly energised.
And it doesn't matter whereabouts they are on the table, Michael. They always seem to lift themselves for this particular fixture.
You're dead right. That's a real hard one to pick. Mm. Maybe Jake can give us an insight into that one.
Now, I think all games, looking through the whole table, I think as testimony to the games on the weekend, they're all going to be very, very tight. And I think it'll take probably 5 or 6 weeks for all teams just to settle down and get a bearing of where they are. I mean, a lot of teams play just on a... adrenaline in the first 1-2 weeks, you know, it's new season, new competition, new players, a new league, new setup. So I think it'll take probably 5 or 6 weeks before you can really start to pick, hey, this team, you know, on paper is really going to beat another side. I think it's very, very early to tell. And I think all games, not only in this league, but certainly in the Premier League and also the State League, it's going to be very tight, three very good competitions.
Definitely. And let's not forget, on Easter Monday, we have Metro Stars v Modbury at TK Shadow Reserve.
Yeah, it's a long weekend, isn't it?
It's a big, long weekend. So that'll be very interesting, because Modbury finished you off in the Cup, didn't they?
Yeah, we started slowly against Modbury in the Len Allegich Cup and went 2-0 down in the first half, clawed our way back to 2-2 and thought we had it an extra time, and they scored with a minute or two to go, and then lost on penalty. So, yeah, we're expecting another tough encounter and... hopefully we can get over the line this time.
It was a good game that way, Mike. I was there and just about hopped in my car and I thought it was all over and went to extra time and then I thought it was all over again and then you guys scored. So yeah, I thought you were a little bit unlucky that day, to be honest. Mm. I thought Metro's probably had the better of Modbury after half time. But that'll be a real cracker. I think it'll depend how many Easter eggs Mike eats on Sunday.
And we should go to the table, Nat, even though we've only played one round.
Yes, it's not really...
Well, it is for our special guest, looking very good.
Well, it is.
Yes. But you wish the league stopped right now.
Nice up there with up the top there with Cumberland. A significant win first round, which the only two of you had. And then we had a draw with... so then we've got Olympic
and Templeton.
Six teams
on 1 point.
Definitely. And then Blue Eagles and Modbury... towards the end of the ladder.
Not a high-scoring round, was it?
No, terrible. Absolutely terrible. I hope we see more goals. It's good football.
I mean, Mike was at our game Friday. I thought it was a good game, and Saturday was a good game. I think you can't always go by the amount of goals. One thing I think the league will do this year is lift its quality and the tempo of the game, and I think it's great to see the quality of the teams that are out in the park.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to get too many, 3-4. No. Well, I don't think you're going to get any 3-4, 5-0 victories unless there's a player or two sent off. So, okay, that'll do us now for our Super League wrap. Coming back after the break, we'll go into the Premier League.
Welcome back to Full On Football. And now we have time for the Premier League segment. And we're going to go straight in and have a look at the teams that are in the Premier League. We've got Adelaide Hills Hawks, Croydon Kings, Enfield City Falcons, Noarlunga United, Northern Demons, Parramatta Hills Knights, Port Adelaide Lion Pirates, Playford City Patriots, Salisbury United and South Adelaide Panthers. And before we go on any further, let's just have a look at the results from round one. We had Panthers and Norlunga drawing on 1-1. Playford absolutely thrashing Pirates 4-0. What a drubbing there. And then we had Northern Demons beating Salisbury United 2-0. Para Hills being victorious over Enfield 1-0. And Joe, Croydon overcoming Adelaide Hills 1-0.
Yeah, up on Saturday up at Woodside, which was a terrific result for us. I think I said at the start of the show that it's been 20 weeks in the making, the pre-season. We started November the 28th, as probably did most of the teams anyway. Probably a little bit longer than what we needed to. And to get the first game for points underway and out the way and be fortunate enough to walk away with 3 points is a real good start for us and something that we can certainly build on going forward now.
Joe, winning up there in Adelaide Hills, I know having played there in the past myself, that is going to be an absolute very difficult road trip for the teams that do have to go up there in the coming part of the season to get the 3 points. You must be delighted, as you said, to get that out the way, get the 3 points in the bag and then head home Saturday afternoon.
Yeah, not just because it's a long way away up in the hills, and the ground is, at this time of the year, it's in quite good nick, which was terrific for us on the weekend. But also Adelaide Hills, they were a very gritty side and they battled very hard and they battled a lot. There was no way that it was an easy win. We had to work very hard and of that we did for the full 90, 95 minutes. And to come away from a team that does battle well was great to get 3 points.
And Joe, you've got a couple of experienced players at the back. How are they coming along for the start of the season, and give us an insight into some of the younger players at your club?
Yeah, certainly the majority of the squad actually are younger players, but it's led by our captain Joe Lagana, who sweeps for the club.
Last year's player of the year, Joe?
Yeah, won the last year's Bob Telfer medal and also won our own Croydon player of the year. He not just leads because he's a captain, he does lead by example, terrific around the young players, and also a very good steadying influence for the rest of the older players in the group as well. We've got some good young players that's come back from the SASSI program, young Michael Dorr, who actually scored the goal on Saturday. He's come back from the SASSI program, a 16-year-old.
Very good player, yes.
Young Forge Folletti, who is also a 16-year-old that's been with the club now for 2 years in the senior side, in the senior setup. So he's doing very well, although he didn't play on the weekend, he was away on holidays. And we've got a 15-year-old boy that's just come back from the SASSI program, a boy called Phil Kira, who represented the Joeys in Laos in the qualifiers not so long ago, a few months ago, and he's come back into the first team, and he got made his debut on the weekend as well off the bench. So there's some real good young players. There's probably the majority of our team are teenagers. We look around, and as a game with probably most of the teams in this competition, and also the State League, a lot of the players that we rely on for experience, it's only experience because they've been around for, one or two seasons, but we do tend to forget they're actually only teenagers still. Mm, so we're quite blessed at our club that we've got some real good ones.
That's right. You did have a bit of an up and down array of cup pre-season. We had, a win, a loss, a win, a loss. But so you would be very happy with that win first start?
Yeah, we had a rusty pre-season. We have been training quite hard. And I don't think in the whole Araya Cup and the Len Algich Memorial Cup that we had the same team week in, week out. We changed it for different reasons, quite largely because not the whole of the squad was available in consecutive weeks. But it was a good chance to have a look at a lot of players. We, I think, looked at about 28 players throughout the whole pre-season, which was good and it served its purpose. But now, of course, we've got to get into what really counts, and points are up for grabs. And I think I said earlier in the show to Michael that you can only afford to maybe lose those 3 games or possibly 4. If you lose any more than that throughout the 18-game season, then you can kiss promotion goodbye.
Yeah. And who do you see, Joe, as your potential targets or your main opposition for trying to knock them off for that top spot? Who do you see that the biggest rival coming from?
Well, I look through the whole league, and I think Alison said before, what this has created, it's created 3 very tight competitions, and certainly the Premier League I see as a very, very tight league. Parry Hills have had a very good pre-season competition.
Very good.
And and mixed it well with the Super League clubs. I think Northern Demons, of course, have done exactly the same. They're going to be very strong. Then you look at Playford, who've come down from last year's Premier League. They've got some good, quick players in that side as well. Pirates always score goals, although Saturday was a bit of an aberration, I dare say, but they're always capable of scoring goals, and not just one or two. They can certainly belt plenty of teams. Salisbury United will always battle. They're a club out there that will always, no matter who plays them, will always battle and scrap and scrape. And I think that even Northern Demons, I heard, scored against the runner play to go 1-0 up on the weekend, and of course ended up 2-0. But Salisbury United, I think, will be a very hard team as well, as will the two teams down south, Noongar and Panthers.
Well, when you look at that group of teams, I think there's all everyone bar one, and I think that Salisbury have been in the upper divisions. In previous years.
Well, Salisbury, I think the last time Salisbury won it was 86. So
right.
They've previously played and not
that's
late.
A long time ago,
yeah.
Well, the others have all been, you know, within that higher division not too long ago.
Absolutely.
So.
And Enfield's another one. I saw them play Saturday night against Parra Hills, and they played, it was a game that probably could have seesawed. It could have gone either way. And Parra Hills ended up getting the 3 points. But not just saying that, I think the whole league is very, very, very tight. And I think any team can beat anyone on any given day.
Now, Joe, you came back from Victoria. How have you seen the standard of football in South Australia here compared to what you were used to seeing over there in Victoria?
I've been largely, of course, in the Premier League, so not in our elite competition within the Super League, so I haven't seen a lot of those games, Brooksy. But the Super League in Victoria, what's called the Victorian Premier League, is a very strong competition. That is because, you know, there's... there was only one or two National League clubs when the old league finished, and all those players, of course, have disseminated into the local league. It's made it a very strong and vibrant competition over there. I dare say, watching Adelaide City, Metro Stars we've played against, and I've seen White City play as well, that certainly the standard here is good. The grounds are conducive for good play, and the players certainly start try to play good soccer. So to compare both equally is very, very difficult because I haven't seen enough of the Super League, but what I have seen, it's been real good, really good.
Let's just have a quick look at the ladder. We've got Playford, Northern Demons, Croydon and Parra Hills there on top, all with wins, and then Noongar and Panthers with a draw, and Adelaide, Enfield, Salisbury and Pirates towards the end of the table. Just looking at this week's round two games, we've got Playford City and Panthers, Playford at home there, Ramsay Park, Northern Demons and Parra Hills at Byrne Park, Croydon and Salisbury at Polonia Reserve, Enfield and Pirates at Rushworth Reserve, and Noongar United and Adelaide Hills at Wilfred Taylor Reserve.
Well, Joe, thanks very much for that Premier League wrap. We'll take a short break and we'll come back with a statement. Welcome back to Full On Football. It's now time to turn our attention to the State League, and with us on Full On Football we have a very special guest, Jim Savalas. Jim, from president from the Adelaide Comets. Jim, welcome to the program.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
Not a problem. Jim, great first up win in Piri last week, winning 4-0. You must have been absolutely wrapped with that first up result.
Yeah, it was an exciting day for the players to take the trip up to Port Piri and to get the 3 points was very fulfilling. Yep.
Well, we'll come back and have a bit more of a chat about the game in a minute. Just to let you know who is competing in this year's Best Bricks and Pavers 2006 State League competition. We have the Adelaide Cobras playing out of Plympton, Adelaide Comets from Santos Stadium at Mile End, Gawler out there at Everston Gardens is their home ground, NAB from Athelstan, Port Pirie City in Port Pirie, Seaford Rangers at Coringle Reserve, the Western District's Toros at Pennington Oval, and the Western Strikers at Carnegie Reserve. Jim, you mentioned to me earlier off air that you took the junior teams up early in the morning, and you opted to take the senior team up a little bit later on in the day. That obviously worked a treat for you.
Yeah, it did. It gave the seniors less time before the start of the game, rather than being up there all day. And the boys went to a ground just down the road prior to the kickoff and did a bit of stretching and warming up. And, it worked out well for the boys. So we'll probably adopt the same method next time, round three.
Now, can you tell us that don't really know a lot about the LA Comets? Where did you originate from? Where are you based? And how did you come about?
Yeah, well, basically, we were encouraged by a group of players to start up a club back in 1994, and we did that with originally two teams in the amateur league, and from there we moved into the city, and the club just grew and grew, and we decided 5 years ago now to start juniors, which was always our intention, to get juniors at our club, and always head towards a state league competition, and that's all come to fruition. So it's been a lot of hard work, and there were structures that had to be put in place, namely facilities, grounds for all the players, and also the administration side of things. And with all the requirements for the state league, it's all come good.
Yeah, Jim, you're mentioning your junior setup. It is a great setup. I always say that whenever we visit down there, you've got a great a group of people that run the junior setup, and it works really, really well. You've got great facilities down there at Ellis Park, and I understand that you're going to be further redeveloping the whole area there.
Well, we've got some proposals ahead of us, and we'll just take that one step at a time with the council, and we'll see how it goes. But there is potential there. And it all takes time, but to have what we've got initially right now is just fantastic for all the kiddies that are there. And the junior is run by Jimmy Karamidis, who's also played at a high level of soccer. And like I said, we've got some great people at the club, and you need that. And it's all working very well at the moment, so we're very pleased with it.
It is working very well, actually. Before we go any further, let's have a look at the results from round one. We had NAB beating Gawler 3-2. Comets defeating Port Pirie, yourselves, we said, mentioned that, 4-0, a great win there. Cobras defeating Strikers 2-1. And Toros and Seaford, a 4-all draw, 8 goals in a game. That's almost unbelievable. It's fantastic.
I think even the results there, Nat, just show what we've reiterated earlier, that there's going to be such an evenness amongst the competition right throughout the three leagues, that, you know, you see Seaford, that have probably been the perennial whipping boys of the past state leagues, now drawing 4-4 Western District. So it's actually brought all three leagues to a real competitive edge, and it's great for the competition. And now, like with the advent of, you know, NAB, Comets, Western Districts coming into the competition, it's made for what I believe is going to be a really close state league. And Jim, like I said earlier, to get the 3 points up there in Pirie at an early stage, although you do have to travel back there because you play each team three times in this competition,
right?
Don't you?
Yeah, that's right.
How are the boys going to find that?
Oh, well, I mean, it's there to be had, and we'll see how we go. And I mean, I think everyone's just excited to be a part of the state league and the new structure of the FFSA, and we'll give it our best shot.
Now, you mentioned before about your training facilities. They're not actually based at the same places where you play your home games, are they?
No, that's right.
So can you let the viewers know whereabouts your training facilities are, in case there's any potential kids that want to come out and perhaps have a go with you?
Well, all our training is done at Ellis Park with all our juniors and seniors.
And where's that?
West Terrace, in the city, Adelaide, right next door to Adelaide High School. Mm. Off to Donald Barber Drive as well. And our state league games will be held at Santos Stadium, which we signed a lease with Sports and Rec, and we'll have our first game there on May the 13th, which we're really looking forward to as well.
Yeah, Jim, is that a short-term lease, or do you see yourself setting up a long-term agreement with the Santos board there to maybe make a home club for yourself, so after the game's played you've got somewhere to go back rather than go back to your training venue?
Yeah, no, you're right. Initially, it is a one-year lease, and we've got next choice to extend that, and we're looking for a five-year lease after that. We're pretty excited about that, and the people are very positive with us. We do have access to the function room at Santos Stadium, which we will be going back up there into the function room after the games, and have a drink and a bit of finger food and stuff and enjoy ourselves. Yeah.
And on the playing side, Jim, can you give us some names that perhaps have maybe been around the soccer scene or the football scene in past that we may know of?
Yeah, we've got a few handful of boys that have played at a higher level. We've had George Atterson goals, and our coach and player coach, Dougie Patterson. We've got George Atsabassis as well, who's played National League, and also John Christopoulos. And blended with those experienced players, we've got some youngsters as well. So it's all moulded pretty well.
Yep. Well, you'd be very excited about this, looking at the ladder after round one with Adelaide Comets on top there. Three teams getting a win from that round. Two teams
Seaford and Toros with a draw, and Gawler, Western Strikers and Piri yet to get any points. Looking at the fixtures for round two, we have Gawler at home to Toros, NAB at home to Adelaide Comets, Seaford at home to Cobras, and Western Strikers at home to Port Pirie City.
Well, Jim, we'd like to thank you for coming in and being a guest, first up guest on Full On Football for the State League wrap. We wish you all the best for the upcoming season. It's good to have Adelaide Comets in the competition, and all the best.
Thanks, Michael, and that, and all the best for your show as well. It's exciting stuff for the whole competition.
And I know, Jim, it's not Greek Easter yet. We've still got to wait a few. Us Greeks have to wait a few weeks, but Kala Pascha, and we wish you all the best for Easter and for the actual season.
Thanks
for coming on.
No problem.
Thanks, Jim. Okay, that's the State League wrap here on Full On Football. We'll take a break and a few messages from our sponsors. When we come back, we'll have an A-League wrap with the CEO of Adelaide United, Michael Petrillo.
Bianco Building Supplies have been providing quality goods and specialised services to the building industry since 1977. Their staff pride themselves in providing total quality customer service. Whether you require machinery, building supplies, drainage, structural reinforcing steel, or hiring of portable on-site buildings, Bianco's friendly and dedicated staff are only too happy to meet your requirements. And if it's safety products you're after, Bianco Safety have an extensive range to choose from. Their safety van can come direct to you, fit out and supply all your safety needs for your worksite. Visit www.bianco.com.au to have a look at their fantastic range of products. Bianco, number one for all your building and safety supplies.
Welcome back to the show. It's time now for an A-League wrap-up, and we're rejoined again with Michael Petrillo, but this time speaking from the perspective of the CEO of Adelaide United Football Club. Michael, most people will be aware of where Adelaide United finished up on the ladder and their unfortunate end to the season, not being able to finish it off with a double. Now, the players have been on holidays. Have they enjoyed their break?
Yeah, look, they've enjoyed the break, but they're looking forward to coming back as well. I think after a couple of weeks have gone by and you're hanging around the house, you start to miss it. And they're professional footballers now, and they really can't wait to get back into it.
And Michael, the players that have gone out on loan to the Super League clubs, Aaron Golding and Bates to the Galaxy, Louis Brain to Raiders, Chad Begija back to White City, Tony Hatzis to Metro, Rob Cornthwaite to Olympic, and Matriciani to Campbelltown. Who had a say in where these players went, or were they basically going back to their original clubs before they went to Adelaide United? What was the process involved there?
Cozzy had a couple of players he wanted to play at certain clubs for various reasons, I think mainly for the fit. But we really left the other players to be approached by any club. Tony, I think, was always going to go back to Metro because that's where he came from. Michael was the same with Campbelltown. We had an agreement with White City Woodville that Chad had to go back to White City, and he was happy to go back there. Olympic approached the club for Robbie. Aaron actually approached me to see if we could come out to Galaxy, and in the end we took Robbie, as I explained before in the show, that was going to go to Croydon, and then sort of hopped out and we took him.
Yeah, it's really good to have these A-League players that come back to the Super League. One, from the point of view of their fitness and getting match time, but two, for the players that are already playing down in that competition, just to see what they've got to do in order to strive to get to where these players are playing at the moment.
Yeah, I agree, Mike. I mean, a couple of years ago I had Richie Elegich come out to Raiders in about round 9 or 10 or something like that, and his commitment to playing there was fantastic, and the players really appreciate his effort, and even with Aaron and Robbie, just bring that extra professionalism to the club.
There's no doubt, Michael, that any young player especially that needs to improve and is going to improve has to play games. And this is a great vehicle to play actually in the Super League competition that in the A-League season. And I can see people like Chad Bajara especially, people like that, and young Tony Hatzis and Michael Matriciani, who didn't play much A-League games, to play and play regularly in a good competition will do them no end of good.
Yeah, they need to play, Joe. I mean, Tony and Michael hardly played a game in the last 8 or 9 months. So without a reserve competition or a youth league, it's very difficult for these blokes to maintain momentum and fitness, because you can train as much as you like, as you blokes know. But if you don't play matches, you don't get that extra sharpness.
Michael, just on the players that are going back to the clubs to get some match time, is there a process or a thought in place maybe to try and make it in conjunction, similar to like the Crows with the SANFL, where, you know, if they're not available or they're not selected for Adelaide United, that they're able to go back and play for a Metro or an Olympic or Campbelltown?
Yeah, look, there is a possibility, and obviously the FFSA would have to approve it as well. There is a possibility that some of these lads may be able to keep playing after the first nine rounds. The FFA is looking at that, in particular the young ones like Tony and Michael and Robbie. Mm. Obviously there's under 23 selection coming up for the Olympic Games, and the FFA do want these kids playing regularly. Young lads playing regularly. They don't want them popping out of football. But in terms of the seasons, it's going to be very hard, because we basically start up and the FFSA season winds down, so there's really nowhere for them to play anyway, Michael.
Yeah. So is it maybe going to take some getting together by the two parties to maybe see if we can bring the leagues in conjunction with each other? Do you see that as maybe a feasible possibility down the track?
Yeah, or even another type of competition, perhaps in the off-season where there's heavier concentration on the youth. I'm not sure, but, you know, all those things take money. Mm. I know the long-term plan of the FFA is to reintroduce the old youth league, which you
yes,
remember, and Joe,
yeah.
you remember. Yeah. Once again, that takes money, and to do it nationally, it takes a seven-figure sum. So it's a lot of money involved. Yeah.
And with the players going back, once the pre-season starts, will they go back and do the pre-season and then go back to, like, say, Tony Hatz's Metro? Will he just go back on a Thursday, or will he train throughout the whole week with Metro? Or what's the training process?
Yeah, no, when they go back, they'll be training with Adelaide United. The first week or two, Cozzy's not too fussed because we're sort of easing into it, but once the first couple of weeks are out the way, I would think that they'd only be training on the Thursday night with their local club, because they're probably going to get flogged a bit, you know, during the day, and to come out again at night and train again, it's going to be a bit difficult. So I think the intention is for the players to train on the Thursday night or the last training night of the week, whichever that might be.
I know, Michael, we've spoken before about Adelaide United players being involved in coaching and coaching development programs for young kids. And I know there's an opportunity coming up next week, for the 2 weeks during the school holidays. And it's the Telstra Football Anytime program.
Yep.
And I know that you're going to be holding sessions at Hindmarsh, where some of your players are going to be involved with 6 to 12-year-olds. Can you tell us which players are involved? Do you know that yet? Or
I don't know all the players. I believe Chad Bajaya and Christian Reese are definitely involved, and a couple of the other lads as well. And it starts on Tuesday the 18th. You can get the details through our website.
Mm-hmm.
A great initiative, and basically it's a program that's designed for anyone who hasn't played the game as well. Very unstructured, if you like. More fun-based sort of activities.
Yes.
As I said, you can get the details off the website, but we'll be holding, or Football Anytime will be holding clinics right around the state, and Adelaide United players will be involved in a lot of those clinics.
And I think it's great that these young kids are able to get out on Hindmarsh as well and train
there.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, they get a big buzz out of it.
Definitely.
It's fantastic for them. Yeah, it's a great program.
Yeah, well, Michael, well, thank you very much for coming in and sharing your thoughts with us, both as the Adelaide Galaxy coach and the CEO of Adelaide United. We appreciate you giving up your time coming into Full On Football. Hopefully we'll catch up with you in the future.
Before you go, I've got something to give you. It is Easter next weekend, and we'd like to give you a Full On Football Easter egg.
Thanks very
much.
And
please drive safely. We'd love, we want everyone to be safe at Easter.
Thanks very much. I'll save them and I'll hand them to Mike the week before we play Metros, I think.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming
in, Mike.
Cheers. Okay, we'll take a few short messages from our sponsors. Welcome back to Full On Football. My next guest I'm very pleased to introduce is the CEO of Saucer, the Women's Federation, and that is Wendy Carter. Wendy, welcome to Full On Football.
Good evening, Michael. How are you?
Good, thank you. The women have gone through a restructure in the federation there. How is can you let us know a little bit about the restructure and how it was formed and how it works?
Yep, certainly can. This year, one of the things that we've done is done away with what we called our reserve division, which was linked to our Premier League. And that came about after a lot of discussion with our clubs, because originally the way the leagues were set up was that you had to have a reserve league to be in the Premier League. But since that time, as you know, juniors have grown out of sight, and nearly every Premier League team now has lots of juniors. So we decided to do away with that and bring in Division 1. But as everything works out, every Premier Division team actually has a team in Division 1. So although there's been a restructure, realistically there's been no change.
So have you found, my next question was going to be, have you found a reduction in the ages that are playing in the First Division as opposed to reserves? Are they getting younger or are you seeing the same age group really coming through?
No. Look, our Premier League, you could near enough call it an under-19.
Mm.
The whole of women's soccer at the moment is a very, very young sport. Maybe our Division 3 and Division 2, which are more social divisions, have got younger players. But I myself play in the Division 1 and I feel like an old granny playing in there. So, I mean, they're very young. And like I said, our Premier League, I think the average age would probably be 18.
Well, I definitely know that in the under-17s, the average age there is possibly 13 or 14, because quite a lot of the younger girls go up to that division and... Oh, it's just unbelievable.
Yeah, I think at the moment we're going for a very big growth spurt in the junior side, especially in the ages of 13, 14. And those players, and the good players are actually moving up to either the under-17s or the open age divisions. So if you think about it, if that continues, we're going to have those players continually come through, and it's looking good for the future, I'd say.
Wendy, have you been able to identify what the appeal is for those younger kids that are coming through in the 14, 15 age groups?
I think now it's a more acceptable sport. I think it's being played more so in schools. Probably 5-6 years ago, it was still a new sport and people getting used to it. But I think it's being promoted very well in schools. And I think now we're getting out there more. And it's a good sport. It's a very skillful sport, not so much contact sport. And I think it's very appealing for parents, because there's a very good career pathway in place for girls who want to play soccer as well.
Yes, actually, let's look at some of the pathways that are available for these young girls. And obviously they start off on the Year 6-7 camp. Mm-hmm. And that's a really fun time. I mean, I know my own daughter went on that and she had a great time meeting people. And even now as she plays games, she recognises girls that she spent time with there. So that was a wonderful opportunity for the really young girls. And then, of course, if they want to go on further, they play in the next lot of leagues, which start at under 11 right through to under 17s. Yeah. And then you go to your development squads, which she, again, has just taken part in that. And that was also, she learnt so many things from that, let me tell you. It has definitely improved her game. And the quality of coaches that you have available to you in those development squads are fantastic.
Yeah. I think we're actually finding the more the sport is becoming acceptable, the players are becoming better as well, because they're coming in the sport a lot earlier, picking up the skills a lot more. And our development squads are now catering for those players who want to go on and do state teams and potentially might be Matilda players.
Well, this year was the first year that you had not only your squad but a shadow squad as well. So there was nearly 50 girls out there.
Yeah. That was very unique this year. We started off wanting to do our age groups according to our state teams, and our under-14s, we got a huge amount of girls, and there was so much quality out there.
Oh,
we would
definitely
have been doing an injustice if we actually said, look, no, we're not going to look after them. So we were really pleased with that.
It's definitely a growing sport, isn't it?
It certainly is, and I think it can grow even better, but I think there's going to be some issues and some barriers we're going to have to deal with, and one of them is going to be facilities. As you've already spoken about with Alison, is the growth in the junior boys. Now if you get the same growth in the girls, where are they all going to play?
Exactly.
And that's somewhere where clubs are going to have to start making some very big decisions, is are they going to cater for both boys and girls? And hopefully they are.
So are you not able to access areas like school ovals or school facilities, or are they already being accessed?
I think some of them are already being accessed, but I think if you drive past a lot of schools on the weekends, they are not being utilised as best they can, and I think that's an area that we're all going to have to look at. As you know, our Sorza's home ground is actually a school ground. We're connected with Annesley College, and again, I think to utilise these facilities even better, I think we're going to become more proactive, not only with schools but with councils as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, Wendy, we of course we've heard of Colette McCullum and Di Aligich as probably the more high-profile women's players in this state. Who's the next batch that we can see perhaps progressing onto the Matildas to perhaps represent South Australia at a national level in World Cups to come?
Yeah, I think Vicky Bellaminos is actually already
in the young Matildas,
and she played the other day, and yesterday actually, and the young Matildas won 1-0 in the Asia Cup, beating China, which is a huge result because China was
very strong.
One of the favourites. So Vicky's already in there, so hopefully she can keep going. Katrina Bexis is another player to watch out for, and she's been identified for the young Matildas as well. Emma Workus, who's a goalkeeper, she's been identified for the Matildas. Right. So,
and she's a great goalie. I've watched her play. She is awesome. She's absolutely so strong in goal as a goalkeeper. Mm. It's very hard to get past her.
Yeah. Emma actually went over to America for a couple of years and spent some time over there, and has come back and has pushed her way into the Matildas. So hopefully we can continue to see her play. But I think in time, there's some talk that there's an under-17 World Cup going to be introduced in 2008. So with the amount of young players that we're getting to come through, and hopefully these career pathways, we'll have a lot more girls pushing for those national teams.
We'd just like to thank you very much for your time, for coming in and letting us know, letting the people out there know more about the women's football. We hope that we'll be able to speak with you every other week and see other people that are involved with your committee and your group, and meet some of these fantastic players that are playing this great league. I had a referee mention to me the other day that he refereed Fulham and Adelaide City Premier League game, and he said, these girls can play. He was absolutely surprised. Yeah.
Let me tell you, the Premier League, maybe apart from one club, which is Parry Hills, who have just come up to the Premier, this year it is going to be so close. Even the couple of score lines that have happened in the last couple of weeks do not illustrate what's out there. I think probably the top eight teams out of the nine, there's going to be some fantastic games. So I'd encourage everyone to get out there and watch it.
Just on that, Nat, the Parry Hills coach of the women's team is none other than Mark Milady, whose daughter Jasmine plays in the women's
team.
So it's good to see a male player getting involved and coaching.
There's
coaching
quite
the girls,
a few of them out there. Actually, last year's one of the equal winner of the Coach of the Year, Max Primara. He's been around for 10 years coaching. So it was great to see that he finally got a Coach of the Year. And who was the
Tracy Jenkins?
Tracy, she's won that before as well, hasn't she?
She certainly has. And at the end of the day, we want good coaches. Yeah. We want to try and encourage more female coaches to come into the game. But at the end of the day, we want good coaches coaching the girls, so we'll be encouraging.
It's a
male
or female.
That's right.
I'll tell you, it's a great competition. I recommend it for any girl interested out there in playing the game. Please go along. And actually, if you access the website www.sawsa.com.au, they'll be able to give you more information on who to contact and where to go around your local area.
Now, if you'd like to give Wendy her
Easter
egg.
I would love to, yes.
So
like
you don't forget to give that. Wendy, it's been a pleasure having you on the show. We hope to catch up with you throughout the year. And as Nat said earlier, even some of your players and other administrators. But thanks for coming in.
Thank you, Michael.
Sharing your time.
Thanks a lot. Happy Easter. Hope you enjoy the break. And thanks very much for coming along and sharing with us what's happening in women's soccer.
Thanks very much, Nat. Thank you, Michael.
Thanks.
Welcome back to Full On Football. Our next segment, which is the amateur league segment, is promoting another branch of football that has huge participation rate in South Australia. And, of course, we are talking about the South Australian Amateur Soccer League. And when you want information about the Amateur Soccer League, who do you go to? Well, you go straight to the top. And therefore, we have the president of the South Australian Amateur Soccer League, Mr. Bill Bailey, with us here tonight. Welcome, Bill.
Yeah, thank you, Nat, and congratulations on your show. I think just hope it goes well for you. I'm glad to be here and perhaps I can help out.
Thank you very much. Look, the South Australian Amateur Soccer League is in its 42nd year, is that correct?
That's correct, yeah.
And you do have an incredible amount of players and teams within this association. Yeah. Would you like to tell us a little bit more about it for those that don't know?
Yeah, I suppose the league kicked off back in 1965 with about 10 teams, a couple of which are still with us. I think I was with Parafield Gardens a couple of weeks ago. They had their 40th year. They're one of the originals, Elizabeth Vale. And they're both still playing in the First Division, which is great. And there's a couple of others there that have been there not quite as long, possibly, but Elizabeth Vale certainly is our oldest club at the moment. And we're continually growing. Our Saturday divisions now have gone out to sort of four divisions, two full divisions of first and reserve teams, and the other two are basically single teams and social teams. Sunday's gone out to sort of divisions 1 through 5 with reserve sides, and 8, 9 and 10, of course, are just purely social sides. Mm. And Division 7 is our just single team squad, our division. So, yeah, they go fairly well. Mm. Yeah.
Bill, perhaps in the past it would be fair to say that the amateurs have probably been somewhat reluctant to maybe get on board with the governing body of the local federation.
Yeah.
What's been the big apple, if you like, for the amateurs to join with the governing body and to really make United, Football United?
Yeah, okay. I should have expected that question, I suppose. I'm surprised you didn't ask it.
No,
didn't ask Alison.
But it's probably a fair question, though, Bill, because people have wondered for years why there's always been, a branched out arm that has been as good as it has, that hasn't been a part of the central competition.
Well, you see, I mean, as far as the old federation is concerned, we were always a member of the federation, affiliated member. As far as this new FFSA are concerned, whilst we've been talking to them, I mean, we've been talking to people from Soccer Australia or FFA and now FFSA for something like getting close to 3 years now.
Yeah.
We are still struggling to come to some sort of what we would consider to be an equitable agreement.
Yeah.
I think to put it into two words, as far as myself and my management committee are concerned, the requests that we're having placed on, or the demands to join FFSA that are being placed on us are, one, we would have to unincorporate ourselves. And as soon as we do that, unfortunately, it would mean that we would lose Grange, or we would lose control of Grange.
Oh, right.
Now, we've just spent sort of $100,000, close to $100,000, putting lights and things in there.
It's a fantastic venue down there.
We've got all sorts of things happening down there. And I think to ask us to do that and lose it, or possibly lose it, I mean, you know, Alison will say that, you know, we should be able to get control of it, and I couldn't guarantee that. I've sort of spoken to several sort of people at the administration offices at the council, and there's no guarantee where it would go, because if we relinquish it, it goes on the open market.
So it'd be basically, you'd need a guarantor, from the federation.
Said that we would need a guarantee, but there's other aspects of it. That's not the sole aspect, of course. We would lose control of, I mean, we wouldn't lose control of our major funds, but we would hold those. They would go into trust. But then you've got the everyday funds, we would lose control of those. And I mean, the league is not inconsiderable as far as that's concerned. I mean, sort of the turnover is fairly large.
Mm.
And for us to sort of then, you've got a situation then, as my people will keep saying to you, is that, you know, you've got a federation that are being, they've got a lot of paid staff. All my people are volunteers from top to bottom.
Mm.
None of them get paid, and they're going to be asked to do the same sort of thing over here as it's happening over here, at much larger sums, and there's a certain amount of inequity in that.
Yes,
plus, we would, with due respect to Alison, we would end up being responsible to Alison, and I don't think, you know, my secretary is going to be too keen on that. If you know Alex, you know that he's not going to be happy about that.
Now, I'll get away from the pointy questions. We'll talk more about the football.
Okay.
One thing that stands out like a beacon is the popularity of the amateur competition.
Mm.
In your opinion, what makes the amateurs such an appealing prospect for players? Because there are ex-Premier, State League, Super League, probably National League players that play in the amateurs.
Yeah, you're quite right. I think there's no one thing you could put your finger on. I think, I consider it to be a well-run competition. We have our moments of glory and our moments of infamy, if you like, but I think all competitions do.
They do.
But at the same time, we have a well-run competition. Everything kicks off on time, or we try to. We don't make it hard for them. We're probably the cheapest soccer competition in the country. I've met sort of soccer officials, amateur officials, and people from all over the country over the last few years, and we really are probably the cheapest amongst them. I know a friend of mine in Victoria, he's the secretary of the amateur league over there, and some of his fines are horrendous. You know, you're talking $200 or $300 if a club's debt's out of line. It's $300 fine. I mean, well, we've never done that sort of thing. You know, we fine people heavily if they do step too far out of line, but never to that extent.
I mean,
it's our registrations are not unreasonable at $30. I mean, I think that's a pretty good.
Is that all it is?
$30 for an amateur player to play for the year. We've just recently, the yearbooks that we've just released, We've now reduced the price of those to the clubs. We used to charge $5 each. I think it's gone down to about three. Mm. So, I mean, that's we've got some good sponsors coming on board now. So, yeah, it's going well.
Well, your registration fees haven't changed much at all, really.
They changed this year for the first time.
Did they?
That's okay. The first hike. We went through a small hike this year for the first time in about 5 years or 6 years, I suppose. But even then, we've counteracted it by giving it back somewhere else by reducing the cost of the yearbooks to the people.
It's a fantastic organisation, and actually over the coming weeks we will be giving results of some of the different divisions with the games that are being played, and we'll introduce you to different people that are involved in the amateur league. And one thing that I really do want to point out to everyone is their fantastic website. It's an excellent website. If you want to find out more information about the South Australian Amateur Soccer League, please go and visit www.saasl.com.au, and you'll be able to find out all about them and their management committee and the different teams that play and up and coming events. It's a really great little website, that one.
I think just as an aside there to that, you've said that you've got photos of the management committee there. I mean, that's one of the factors that we have. I mean, I was sitting at home this afternoon before I came down thinking about this. I think I counted up that over the management committee, we've got something like about 160 years between us.
Yeah.
I mean, Alex has been there almost for 30 years plus. Bobby Cox has been there for about 30 years. I've been there 29.
Yeah.
Bobby Cox used to play at Para Hills in the old amateur side.
And 2005 Hall of Fame inductee.
Oh, well, that's quite right.
Yes, well, Alex was very proud moment last year.
Alex was inducted the year before, mm-hmm. or 2 years before, and Bobby this year. Yeah, it's very good. Yeah. So, yeah, we've got people there that have been there for a long time. Yeah. And practically all bar two of them are life members of the Amateur League, so they've all been there a long time.
It's great, isn't it?
They've given
loyal people to football.
And they do work well, and they're all interested in the game.
And when I was involved with the Amateur League back in 97, 98, I had lots of wonderful times speaking to
your
committee.
I'm sure you did.
Especially at the tribunal.
Well, I was going to say, you were always in trouble, Matt.
No, it wasn't me, it was the players.
Okay.
But we do. It's a great committee and a great organisation, and we thank you for your time for coming
tonight.
Okay. Thanks,
no, you're quite welcome. I hope it all goes well for you.
Thanks, Bill.
If I can help at all, just give me a call.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
It's been a pleasure to have you on the show, Bill.
Thank you.
That was Bill Bailey, the president of the Amateurs, and great to have him on. So I dare say we'll talk to Bill throughout the whole season. We'll take a short break. We'll be back with Full On Football. Port Road Sports Store. If it's football gear you want, come into Port Road Sports Store, your football specialist store. Official outlet for all Adelaide United merchandise. Stocking football brands like Umbro, Mitre, Lotto, Kelme and Roosh. Come in and see their extensive range of sporting goods and equipment. Port Road Sports Store, 142 Port Road Hindmarsh, proudly supporting football since 1982.
Welcome back, and now we have the junior segment. It's an area of football that has a high participation rate with many, many, many young footballers playing each Sundays. Now, if we look at the actual setup of the juniors competition, we have quite a number of teams there in A, B and C divisions. And just these alone, this is not including the under-8s to under-11s that play also within clubs. We can see there that there's a total of 146 teams, and as it says, another 122 teams in the under 8 to under 11 division, so approximately 4,000 players in the junior competition alone. I mean, that must be an awesome task to coordinate that, Alison.
Oh, it is. Can you imagine? I think there's something like 85 games on the weekend within each division.
Yeah.
That's an awful lot of games.
It is. It's an incredible amount. And it's good to see that it's sitting so healthy with many, many kids participating in it. If we just like to look there at the under 16, we see that that includes Sassy Girls. Now, they've always played in the under 16 competition. And let me tell you, they're quite an awesome team, that under 16.
Yes, I haven't seen them yet, but I'm looking forward to them. I have heard the same, yes.
Mm. Well, I had a couple of people come up to me on the weekend saying that they wandered down to this game and saw girls playing against boys and sort of were inquiring what's going on, and they found out and they said, these girls can really play.
Mm. And look, that's a huge growth area for the sport as well, and I know you're having Wendy Carter on as well to talk about that, but it's certainly an area that we want to promote. It's a great sport for women.
Alison, when you go to the soccer these days, it is absolutely unbelievable to see so many kids wearing Adelaide United tops or local Premier Super League club tops rather than the overseas Manchester United, AC Milan, those type of tops. You must be really pleased with how that side of the things have come along for the juniors.
Yeah, and you've got to remember too that those figures that you just quoted, the 4,000, that's our junior Premier League, but there's probably another 12,000 juniors outside of that playing in schools and other club competitions. So it's a huge sport.
Would we have the most participated played sport out of all the codes
in
Australia?
Oh yes, by far.
By far?
Yeah, yes, certainly soccer, the old soccer, the new football, is definitely the highest participation rate sport.
What do you think as a governing body that we can do to promote the juniors a lot more than what perhaps has been done in the past?
I think one of the challenges for us is to make sure that at every level that juniors are playing is that there are some pathways for them, that there's the opportunities to be the best they can. And whether that's just playing for recreation or playing competitively or whether they've got the potential to develop as elite athletes, I think it's part of our responsibility to make sure that they get those opportunities.
Now, would you like to perhaps run through the pathways?
Definitely.
For the
we do have pathways now for these young kids that do want to further their career in football. And as we can see on screen there, they can start off with the football, Telstra Football Anytime, that we spoke about before with Michael Petrillo, which is basically an introduction to the game. And from there, they go to clinic skills programs, they go to academies. As they progress higher up in their age group, they're able to access state development programs. And then the real business end comes where they start getting into SASE programs, state programs. And then, of course, if they are skilled enough and good enough, they reach the national levels, which is the JOIs, under-17s, then the Australian Institute of Sport, with the possibility of making it into Adelaide United, and then who knows, if they further themselves again, they're able to be, you know, Socceroos playing for their own country. So it's fantastic to see that there is something set up for them now to be able to pursue, you know, a dream if they have, to take it further.
And are all the clubs made aware of these pathways, Alison, in terms of like providing the correct teaching for their kids to follow in this pathway? Mm,
that's part of what we're doing. And, of course, at the moment we're promoting a lot within our own leagues. But, again, there are other associations out there that would benefit from understanding these pathways and for helping us get their juniors involved with these pathways.
Yep. And with the development programs, one thing I think that football, the old soccer, has been able to do is to bring underprivileged communities to be able to play the game of football. Do the Federation give any assistance or help or guidance to perhaps some of these players or clubs that perhaps aren't very well off in terms of financial backing or some endorsements?
We don't have any programs in place at the moment, but we're very much in the early days with those sorts of developments. I think the Telstra Assistance Fund, that's something we're going to be promoting. And last round, that's obviously a national fund that's being supported by the FFA. We had about $13,500 come into South Australia in terms of goods. And obviously, if the club's finding it hard to fundraise or is disadvantaged financially, that's a huge opportunity.
Certainly is.
And speaking of opportunities, we have an advertisement for school clinic coaches that are wanted. And this is Richie Aligich, who's the school clinics coordinator at the moment. He's looking for coaches to conduct these clinics during school hours. Applicants just need to have a minimum of a junior licence and be registered as a coach with the FFSA. And if you are interested in applying to become a coach for these young kids, just send your expression of interest and coaching resume to the address there on the screen. And I'm sure that they would be very happy to hear from you because obviously that coaching and administration and officials is an area which we do require more people to join those areas. So if you'd like to do that, please write to that address on the screen.
We have a very large demand from schools for clinics now, and that's partly why. It's part-time position, I have to say, or several part-time positions, but what we're trying to do now is recruit and just get a group of coaches that we can use when we get our peak times, which are usually terms 2 and 3. Mm. And Richie's doing a great job coordinating that, but it is rapidly expanding.
Mm, definitely it is, yes.
Well, Alison, we'd like to thank you for coming in and sharing your time here on Full On Football. It's been a pleasure to have you. It's good to finally put a face to the name, I must say, even for myself, who's been around the game for ages. But having met you and obviously heard you tonight, I'm sure that our game of football, the one we all love, is in good hands, and all the best for the future.
Thank you very much.
And once again, we'd like to wish you a happy Easter like we do with all our guests, and give you a full-on football Easter egg, and hope you enjoy the weekend.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Thanks, Alison.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Full On Football. Just before we close the show, Nat, would you like to give this week's Federation Cup fixtures out, please?
Oh, I certainly would. We've got 4 games, which is a preliminary round being played on Monday, Easter Monday. Games, seniors games starting at 2:30. We have Parahills West versus Stirling Districts at Manor Farm. Riverland up against NAB all the way up at Berry. So have a good trip, NAB. Adelaide Wanderers v Adelaide Comets at the Venuta Club. And Ross Trevor are up against Gawler at Polonia Reserve. So I might go have a look at that one.
And the times for those now?
And they're all being played. The seniors are being played at 2:30. There's one under-23 game, which kicks off at 12 o'clock, and that's Sassy versus Comets at the Venator Club.
Very good, Nat. Thanks for that. Okay, just before we do close, Nat, just on a side note, I'd like to congratulate you for finally getting Full On Football up and running and on the air. I know you've done a tremendous lot of work over the last 12 months, and, well, finally it's here. We've done the best we've can. We've done the best that we can. We'll continue to try and improve and bring you the show that hopefully brings you a lot of information and some good light-hearted humour along the way. So,
yeah.
Nat, well done.
Thank you. Yes, definitely. That's what this show's about, is about getting the information out to you. And if you have any information that you want to let us know about, which is, you know, anything about the club, anything that you've got, any competitions coming up. Actually, I do have something that's coming up, and that's a benefit for Mickey Dye at Modbury Soccer Club. And that's on Saturday the 22nd
of April,
yes. 7 o'clock, I think it starts. We've got it up on the screen, the graphic. Mickey Dye is not very well at the moment, and it's unfortunate it has to take something like this to get people out to support him, but he's a fantastic guy, and I think everyone should get along to that venue and really congratulate and just appreciate the things that he's done, not only for his club, but for the game of football.
I think he was on the inaugural Adelaide United board as well.
He was. But again, if you've got any information that you want to let us know about, contact us on our email address, which is adamn@optusnet.com.au, or you can send us a letter at our post office box, 319 Henley Beach 5022.
We'd like to thank you for watching the first edition of Full On Football. Also like to give a big thank you to our special guest panellist, Joe Mullen. Joe, thanks for coming in.
Yeah, pleasure to be on the show, and good luck with it for the season. It's terrific for our game.
Thanks, Joe.
Thank you very much. Yes. Thanks for giving up your valuable time, and like with everyone, we'd like to wish you a happy Easter and give you a Full On Football Easter egg.
Thank you.
And, good luck with the season, and hope everything goes well with Croydon. We wish you all the best.
Thank you, Joe. And same to you guys. Thanks.
Thanks very much for joining us tonight, and we hope we can catch you again next week.
Big thanks to Bianco and to Port Road Sports for sponsoring the show.
Definitely, couldn't have done it without them.
And remember, don't run on empty, get Full On Football. See you next week.
Here we go. Here we go.